can't stop. It's already happening. It's happening.
No! All right, folks. If you're watching live right now, give me a sec. Ready? In 3, 2, 1. Good evening. It's Wednesday, May 3rd. And following a stunning, thrilling overtime victory for the San Jose Barracuda over the Stockton Heat, eliminating them in all 5 games, we've got a show here. It's Barracuda After Dark. And on tonight's edition, we are going to talk about the series against the Stockton Heat and preview the upcoming series in round 2 against the San Diego Gulls. Of course, if there are any other Barracuda-related topics that you'd like to discuss on tonight's Barracuda After Dark and you're watching live on YouTube, send your comments through on the Google chat and we'll go over some of them on the air. You can also be a part of the show on Twitter. Use the hashtag BarracudaAD. Is that right, Ian?
Use whatever hashtag.
Use whatever. Just send in your tweets to Tealtown USA. On tonight's panel, it's me, that guy from the former writer's room. You know me and my little makeshift graphic. I'm at Kevin Lacey 22. I'm really excited if you couldn't tell. Joining us tonight, our very special guest. She's the cutie from SAP Center. Please welcome Kaleigh Krish.
Wow, the cutie. I love the introduction, Kevin. Thank you.
And last but not least, definitely the most beloved, cutest, most handsome, I don't know, put in your adjective, the man from Canada himself, Ian Reid.
Woo!
There you go.
Nice, little happy face. Nice avatar there, Ian.
Thank you. Thank you, Avatar Stickman. I think that's how it goes. Hey guys, thanks for joining us a little bit later than we expected to go. Obviously happy to have you here. Happy to talk about obviously the Barracuda after a nice win on I don't even remember what night it was anymore. It was Tuesday night, wasn't it?
That was Tuesday, yesterday. Yes.
Okay. That's how tired I am today. We're excited to talk about some Barracuda, obviously. So thanks for everyone for tuning in. I know, you know, it's always awesome when we get, so many people watching when we're talking AHL. It's great. So let's get this thing rolling. San Jose Barracuda vanquished the Stockton Heat in 5 games. What did you think of the game, Kevin? Start with you.
No. Ladies first. You gotta go to Kaleigh.
Oh, ladies first. Sorry, Kaleigh, go ahead.
Oh, it's okay. It's definitely okay. I actually do want to hear Kevin's opinion, but as the announcer there,
said
I mean,
nobody
I was,
ever, by the way,
I can't even put into words how that game was. It was all emotions possible. I was completely sure. I was completely terrified. And I was completely elated at the end. So I got to experience the roller coaster of emotions last night. And to be able to be in that environment with so many fans, we had an amazing turnout last night of just people who love hockey, whether they miss the Sharks, whether they're diehard Cuda fans, or even the Stockton Heat fans that were there. I mean, everybody was just there to support a great hockey. And obviously, the Pacific Division knows how to do it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, of course, we might be a little bit biased here because, heck, we're following a Pacific Division team. But when you've got San Jose, San Diego, Ontario, and look at the effort Stockton put up. Like, how do you deny that this is not the best division in the American Hockey League?
Yeah, no, I can't argue with that at all. I mean, I'll admit I don't watch a whole lot of AHL hockey from the other conference. I catch a few of the Central Division teams, like when we rolled through and when they came to play the Barracuda. But I mean, you look at the series. I mean, they all went to the both of the series both went to the limit. So, oh, good, we got questions too. So I think that it was a fun series. I definitely had me a little bit biting my nails a little bit because it just was like, for me, it was like one of those games, you know, the Barracuda were piling up the shots and I was just like, oh God, no, like this is just, it was one of those games where, you know, you're just like, okay, they're doing good. Grossnick looks good, but you're just like in the back of your head a little bit, you're just like, oh, you know, one break for Stockton and it'll be in vain. You know, all those shots are in vain.
And it's true, because I actually talked to Kaleigh during second intermission last night, and I said, even though the Barracuda actually put up more shots, 23 shots in the second period, I thought that the quality of shots diminished quite a bit in that second period over what David Rittich faced in the first period. So it was like, oh gosh, I hope we're not trending downward as this game goes on.
Yeah.
That was pretty tough to watch, because obviously you go from the first period into that intermission thinking, I mean, none of us had any idea that Rittich would have been, that was going to be pulled. And when you see Gillies coming in the second, I got very concerned, because I was thinking, what is going on? You know, he's had a lot, it could have totally gone either way. He's had a lot of rest, so he could either be more prepared, or he's had too much rest, so he could be rusty. And I was thinking, what is the strategy to this? Because no one had, I mean, it didn't look like Rittich had an injury. It didn't look like anything had happened. So I was very like, is this some sort of strategy that's going on? I was concerned. You know, most people would be like, very excited that, oh, the number one goalie came out and the backup's coming in. No, I was the opposite. I was very concerned. And then to watch him take so many shots, but like Kevin said, they were not quality shots. And mm-hmm. I think what Roy Sommer really tries to ingrain in them is shots on net, shots on net. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the perfect quality. Just get the goalies to face the shots and something will go in. And I think that, I mean, it took them, what, 48 shots on goal by the end of the third, and they had one goal. 48 shots. They ended with 54 shots on goal. I think that's unheard of.
Yeah, absolutely. We got a question for you in the chat already, Kaleigh, so I have to ask you this, because I don't want it to scroll away, so I don't want to forget it. AO12345 asks...
Who I met last night, by the way. Thank you for introducing yourself to me.
He asks, is John Root that hyper outside of work? Does he tell everyone to make some noise?
You know, the make some noise part, we joke around with him a lot that that's pretty much his catchphrase that he just says all the time. But yes, John Root is that hyper outside of the games. He's great. He's a very positive person. He is very happy a lot of the times, and I've never seen him upset or mad or anything like that. Barely stressed most of the time. Although last night, I do have to say, I did see the terror in his eyes, especially when Shinkarik had that breakaway in overtime. Him and I both looked at each other with, I mean, we were white as ghosts, and yes, we're white as ghosts most of the time, but this in particular, we both looked at each other like, I mean, we were zombies. Like, we talked about this after the game. We were like, we both died for a few seconds. Like, we absolutely died. But to answer your question, yes, John Rue is that hyper outside of games. And asking people to get loud, I think if you were to walk up to him on the street, he would probably tell you to get loud.
Good to know.
If I ever just realized that Google took my sound effects bar away now, so I can't even do like an applause for that answer.
I love that question, by the way. That's awesome.
Perfect. Thank goodness for the poster and that breakaway. It was kind of and this was kind of brought up too. Where was it here? Just Vince G was saying, you know, it was just a weird situation for goalies in the Pacific all around. Like, I think Ontario went to like their third string at one point.
Yeah, they played Jack Flynn in game 5 against San Diego.
I guess Campbell got hurt in practice or warm up, and then their backup got hurt, or I don't remember the exact chain of events, but I remember Nolan Berger mentioning it during the commentary. It was just a weird night for goaltending to go around.
Yeah. Yeah. But going off of what Kaleigh was saying about that Shinkarik breakaway, I'm going to name drop here. I was texting with Danny Miller, arena voice of the San Jose Sharks. Shout out to Danny. I was texting with him during the intermission and saying, you got to turn the game on. And then basically my next text is, oh my God, Shinkara, get the post. What is going on?
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. And I'll be completely honest with you. I did not watch it. I didn't watch Shinkara. I didn't watch it because I saw him break away and I literally crumbled to the ground and hid my head and waited to hear the sound of that post. And I got up and people were cheering, but it wasn't like, I think everybody was in shock. So it wasn't the overwhelming sound of, okay, cool, we didn't get scored on. But so it could have very easily been the Stockton Heat fans cheering. Yeah, so right. I stood up and it took me a good probably 15 seconds to realize that it didn't go in and we still had life.
Well, there was still like that moment after it hit the post where it hit the post, hit the back glass and came back at Grosnick. And it was like, oh, it's not over yet.
Yeah. So it reminded me, like, that play kind of reminded me of that stanchion goal in Vancouver. It took the funny bounce off the stanchion and just, you're just like, no, please, no, not, don't do this to the Barracuda now, too, hockey gods. Please, no. Go ahead.
Ian, let's go through the goals because Calgary, there we go. One drink for me. Stockton took the lead with that weird goal from Jamie DeVan where it was just like, whoa, no, not a side of the net scrambly play. And why is their enforcer wide open in front?
Yeah. I don't know. That makes no sense. It was an interesting, you know, it was an interesting goal. And it's kind of surprising that that was the one that they put in the net, to be honest. Like when you think of the opportunities that the Heat had throughout the game, you know, to be that one was the goal. That was something else for me anyway.
Well, and that one was where, I mean, Grosnick was on the other side, the other side of the net and trying to come back. And it was definitely one of those things. It was like just barely if he would have been an inch further, it probably wouldn't have went in. Like it was just one of those things that, you know, how lengthy he is and how easily he's able to get to the other side of the post. And it just didn't happen for whatever reason. Like you said, the hockey gods were in Stockton's favor at that moment and they just couldn't stop it, which is funny because he stopped harder shots than that on a daily basis.
Yeah. Yeah. He Grosnick let in some interesting goals this series. And I think, you know, if the Barracuda are going to be successful, Grosnick's going to have to get a little bit more back on his game. Like just looking at the, you know, I mean, look, his defense did him no favors, so I'm not completely laying this out on just Grosnick, but still at the same time, a 907 save percentage, just, you know, you need better.
Yeah. But I will say, though, I mean, granted, I missed pretty much the entire series while I was down in Southern California, but from what it sounded like from your show's past, it sounded like the defense and Troy needed to be really stellar in game five because they were a little suspect at times. But I thought by all accounts the D were great. Goaltending obviously great in game five. Grosnick not tested often, but those are the ones that you worry about, the games that you worry about.
Absolutely.
Look at Evgeny Nabokov's career was plagued by 40 saves on 41 shots and then 5 goals against on 13 shots kind of nights, you know? So
yeah,
nice to see that Troy remained focused.
Okay, so Vince G, bringing up the speed. So Jack Campbell had a concussion before the game started.
Okay.
Zakhtoff got injured in warm-ups. And then Campbell, it was weird. So Zakhtoff got injured, and then Campbell, I guess, apparently the AHL doesn't have concussion protocols, apparently came back into the game. It was all kinds of weird.
Oh, really?
Probably long enough to... Probably just because they had to get the third goalie gear on, so someone had to go in net.
Oh. Why couldn't they get Rob Tallis like what the Panthers did last year?
I don't know.
What about Jonah Emu's dad? Didn't Jonah's Emu's dad like back up for a game for Ontario or something at one point?
So let's talk about some of the things that were a little concerning from the first round, obviously, because I think that, you know, like the Barracuda definitely came out, but man, I don't think I have any nails left from last night's game. Like it wasn't like I went into game five thinking, man, this is a slam dunk for the Barracuda. Like, obviously I want the Barracuda to do well. And, you know, I'm a fan first, but at the same time, I was really nervous that game.
Yeah.
So what concerned you, Kevin? Any stats or anything that stand out to you?
It's power play. I mean, yeah. I'm going to pick off the easiest one here, but the power play is now, what are they, 1 for 23?
1 for 22.
1 for 22. Mm-hmm. And this is a power 5%. Play that, I don't have my stats up, but I think they were third or fourth in the league.
They were second in the league during the regular season.
Right. Mm-hmm. So my question is, and I wish I'd had time to look this up beforehand. How has the power play been since Nikolai Goldobin was traded? Because the Barracuda are way too talented to go 1 for 22 on the power play. Yet, for whatever reason, they have fallen off a little bit without Goldobin. And something's got to get changed up. For me, I think the blue line needs to get changed up on the power play. But what do you guys think on that?
Wow. Yeah, that's actually an interesting take that I hadn't even thought about, is what has it been since he's been gone? And if I remember correctly from regular season, I mean, I guess it really was usually him. I mean, he didn't score often, let's be honest.
No.
But when he did, it was in those key moments, like most likely the power play goals or the game winning goals. So he could be someone who maybe shines harder when they're down like that. That's interesting. And I remember talking to Ryan Carpenter last night about that exactly, because at the time, after the first intermission, they were 1 for 19 on the power play in the series, which is, I mean, insane. I actually heard a fan in the background right before my interview saying, they're about as good on the power play as the Sharks are. And I was like, like, okay, guys, let's give them a second.
Those comparisons are being drawn, though.
Yes, they are. And so, and you have to understand it from an organizational standpoint. Like, why wouldn't you draw those conclusions? And if the Sharks aren't being able to execute on that front, then why would the Barracuda? But like I said, they were second in the regular season. So what is changed about the and playoffs?
Stockton's penalty killing, if I recall from the preview show, was somewhere around 19th.
It was bad.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it definitely wasn't Stockton. It was the Barracuda beat themselves on the power play for sure. It was not Stockton. I think Rittich had some great saves in the first with those two penalty kills that he faced.
Yeah, absolutely.
But but other than that, I mean, I would love to see the stats for how many shots on goal they had during a power play.
Yes.
So for your for you, Kevin, Nikolai Goldobin had 15 goals while playing for the Barracuda, and 5 of them were on the power play.
Okay. Ian, I'm a little concerned about your audio chopping up here, just so you know.
Okay. I don't know what's going on. I think my internet's being kind of
okay
tonight.
Oh, that Canadian internet.
Oh, we got to get the moose back on the treadmill to get the power running properly.
Awesome.
It's hard life.
AO12345 says the reason the power play is not scoring enough is because people aren't in the stands yelling shoot enough. That's got to be the issue.
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry about my audio, guys. I apologize. Usually I'm pretty solid here. I had notes here somewhere.
They do call you the angry Canadian robots, and that's what you're
saying. I might as well sound one for once. I think the concerns for me on the power play, because I think the power play is obviously the biggest concern at this point. Although I think I still have concerns with the middle pair of Bergman and Mueller. Although I think they'll have an easier time against. I think they won't be. I think, like I said on previous shows, I think one thing with Mirko that his decision making is still a little suspect, especially when you really pressure him. And obviously with a team like Stockton that's coming at you all the time, they really exploited some of that poor decision making. And I'm hoping that against the goals that gets rectified a little bit, because I think the goals are heavy, but they're not Stockton heavy. So I think that the other thing that concerned me with the power play, I think a big part of it might be also is that you've had these players kind of get reintegrated into the lineup and are obviously getting opportunities, you know, the Timo Meyers and Nick Sorensen's, Oregon to a lesser extent, even though he's been there for the entire
Even Marcus Sorensen.
Yes, not Nick Sorensen, Mark and Sorensen. So I feel like those guys getting back into the power play, you know, you've obviously shuffled things up to get those guys back in there, and why wouldn't you want them there? Don't get me wrong. But I think that has kind of thrown off their mojo a little bit because you're changing things on the fly like that. I don't know. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, I think that's a good point that you make and I always wonder about that. What is it really like for the team when players come down from the parent team? And I always want the real answer, which I never get. So I would love to know what that actually is, but being in the position I'm in, I'll never get it. But I do think that it has to have some sort of structural difference for them because they're not used to playing with these guys. And I mean, we all know that when you get into the NHL, sometimes that affects your ego a little bit more than it did when you were playing with these guys 2 months ago. So who knows how the attitudes have changed as well. But I think that it kind of helps the Barracuda that the Sharks are not in it, because at least these guys are getting a chance to play for
right.
a title. Yeah, so I think right. that helps. But I do agree. I think the switch up affects them and they need to work at it. And hopefully, I mean, we don't play again until Friday. They got a day off today. So hopefully in the next few days, they'll really be able to work that. Cause I can't imagine that Roy Sommer is happy with a 1-22.
Yeah. No. I mean, how could you be? I think, you know, I think the kids probably you want to see the kids get a little bit more on the score sheet. I mean, obviously Ryan Carpenter has been fantastic, and I think that you've seen like more of the veterans come through so far. But I think, you know, if the Barracuda are going to go deep, they need to get some of these kids going too. You know, I know Regan has some points, but you want to get obviously Kevin LeBanc going a little bit more. Sharchey done everything but score, right. and he's just been robbed. Like I feel bad for Sharchey because he's been so good, but I mean he has the 5 assists, but he doesn't have anything in the goal column, and he's just been robbed repeatedly. So I think, you know, you kind of want to see that going. What did you guys like from round one? Or go ahead, sorry, Kevin.
To what you guys said about the basically the reassignments in Kevin LeBanc and Marcus Sorensen et al., Timo Meier, I really thought they all played strong in game 5. Like, I think we have talked on these After Dark shows before about wanting more out of these players. And yeah, outside of Timo Meier scoring the game tying goal, statistically, they weren't on the box score. But I think that the effort level was absolutely what you need from guys who have NHL experience like those three. And right. and again, Barkley Goodrow, another guy, he only played a couple games for the Sharks this year, but another guy that you expect to step up in crunch time in game 5. So I do think that while they've been a little inconsistent since being reassigned, they all brought it when it needed to be brought to last night.
I know, it's so funny because like I don't even consider, like I know like Goodrow's like what, 23. I don't even consider, like when I talk about the kids, I'm not even talking about Barkley Goodrow anymore.
Oh
like,
no.
He's more in the Carpenters.
He's in the veteran. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
No, he is.
Veteran guy. But no, I mean it's a good point, you know, because you forget sometimes though, like how old that some of the veteran players actually are. What did you guys like from the first round as far as just things that stood out to you that you really liked and you think will help the Barracuda going forward? Kaleigh, I'll start with you.
Oh, man, what did I like that I think will help them going forward? Let's see. Honestly, I like the fact that those guys have been reassigned and that they will be playing down with us, because I think that that will only benefit in the long run. Yes, it may have caused a shakeup this week, but I think in the long run it's going to be really beneficial, because look who was making big time plays for the Sharks during the playoffs. It was Timo Meier and Marcus Sorensen. I mean, they were bringing the physicality to the game. They were bringing the rush to the game. They were bringing everything that they needed. They did with the Sharks, and I hope that they will bring that to us, which I believe that they will. Other things I liked the fight. Barracuda really seemed to want this. And you don't always see that with teams once they're once their NHL level team is done, you kind of see, especially towards the end of a long season like this, they start to get a little, I guess, homesick maybe, or just want the season to be done. And I think for this group of guys, they really do want this. They want to bring the cup. And I think that that's great. I love the teamwork that's happening. I love the adjustments that are happening. Because you can definitely tell the difference between a first period and a second period and a third period. So they're definitely going in the locker room and figuring out what needs to happen. Now, that doesn't always come out and translate to what you think it's going to. You would think that they would get better as the time goes on. And sometimes they bring their all in the first and the second they look dull. But I like those things about it. And my only concern, I think, really is just the power play and a little bit defensively. However, I did want to make a point, though, that I have seen so much improvement in Mirko Mueller this year that I am almost floored by it, because there is a number of games where I look and I think, wow, he's really making moves. And I do agree with you that sometimes when he's in his own zone and trying to make a decision, you can see that hesitation of it. But I think he really puts his body out there lately, which he hasn't done. He didn't do last year. He didn't do the year before. And his speed is getting up there. So I'm actually pretty impressed with him. Now, my other concern, though, was yesterday with Tim Heads. He missed a lot of passes, and that is not characteristic of him. So I'm hoping that with a few days rest, he'll be able to come back and get back to the goal scoring defenseman that we know.
Yeah. And I Tim Heads, a guy that I have a very keen eye on for the playoffs, because last year, right before he signed, I did an article on the, what is now tealtownusa.net or .com. Check it out. About how Tim Heads is a guy who oozes offensive potential from the blue line. But watching him play in Sweden, he's a guy who really was taken advantage of physically. So in round one here against the Heat, a team that plays physical, their best asset besides goaltending is their forecheck. And I think that Heads struggled a little bit with that. So he's going to have to step it up, because the playoffs are only going to get harder from here. He had that game. He had that goal in, was it game four? I think he scored in game four. So hopefully that's the start of something. He has a couple goals in the playoffs now. But you're right. He almost seemed a little bit hesitant at times in his own decision-making. And I don't know if it had something to do with the tempo was a little different from what he was used to or what, but the Barracuda definitely need more out of Tim Heads. And that could also translate with the power play woes as well, when he is the big gun on the blue line there.
Well, I mean, I think with that, you guys can hear me still, right?
Yeah, actually, you sound better.
Perfect. I messed with my computer a little bit. I think we're okay now. I think the thing, you know, we saw teams know, especially these Pacific Division teams, I mean, they've seen Tim Heads 14 times this year, you know, and I think it's kind of similar to what happened to kind of at Brent Burns at the end of the season too, where it's, I think people just know, you know, they kind of expect that play. They expect that, you know, they expected Thornton to Burns and then Pavs is going to try and deflect it. I think you can probably relate that a little bit to Tim Heads as well. I think Tim Heads has a very specific approach, although with the Barracuda, at least they have Joachim Ryan on the other side that also likes to shoot the puck. So I think that helps. I think that might be part of, I wonder if part of the issue is just that teams have kind of just, they've wisened up to that, because I think Tim Heads has been such an important part of this team's offense all year.
Yeah.
You know, him and O'Regan really, those are the two guys, in my opinion, that really have kind of carried the water for the Barracuda, and everything that kind of happened usually comes off of one of their sticks.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, obviously you want to see Tim Heads get going again, but I wonder if it's just that he's getting more attention because teams are kind of just on to him.
That's true. That's true. I'm going to take the advantage of this from the chat and what you just said, because I always love gushing about Joachim Ryan. Boy, he had a great game last night. Boy, he had a good man. There are a number of either one-on-ones or two-on-twos that it was a nice little quick stick, and the transition goes the other way. Oh man, Joachim Ryan with a very strong defensive game, I felt last night.
Very great game, however.
Okay. however, I know where you're going with this.
However, he did have, I mean, it worked to our advantage, thank goodness, but he did have that delay of game, which I don't blame him for because it wasn't really, it definitely wasn't intentional, but the delay of game in overtime could have really been our ticket to out of there.
Yeah, definitely. I can't, yeah. I mean, Joachim Ryan to me, I mean, that's the... as much as Tim Heat has done on the offensive end of the puck, I still think Joachim Ryan's the best defenseman on the team. And I don't, you know, other than Heat, I don't think it's close.
Absolutely.
I think the things that I really liked that I like going forward, I really love Timo Meier's game. I know Kaleigh brought this up earlier. Timo Meier has been, you know, I don't know what happened because, like, I've been kind of hot and cold on Timo all year. You know, whether it be on the Sharks or on the Barracuda, but I don't know what happened. Like, the second the playoffs started, like, a switch went off in his brain, and he was just, I mean, I thought he was great in the playoffs. Yeah, the points weren't there, but, I mean, the way that he got under Lucic's skin and just, you know, he knew what his role was, and he played it really, really well. And now on the Barracuda, I love the forecheck. His shot selection could be a little bit better still, but it's improving. I feel like it's improved, especially in the playoffs. So he's been a big plus for me, especially, you know, like I said, this is a guy I was kind of, you know, hot on and then cold on, and now I'm just completely on the Timo time bus again. Anything from you, Kev?
No, I kind of want to ask just a off-topic question.
Uh-oh, yeah.
What do you think's going on with Dan Kelly?
Nick DeSimone happened to Dan Kelly.
You really think so? Because, I mean, Dan Kelly was in and out of the lineup with various injuries throughout the season. And I wonder, I mean, yeah, okay, Dan Kelly's not the fleetest of foot, but he's there to make a difference. You know, play the body up against a team that is very physical, like Stockton, and Kelly gets one game as the seventh defenseman. I know DeSimone has done great so far, but I don't know. You think he's banged up? Kaleigh, you got any intel that you know of that you can share publicly?
You know, I wish I did. I really don't, because my question was, you want that big body out there, especially for Stockton. And right. I was kind of wondering, in a game five, when you know that they are going to come out physical, and I'm actually surprised they didn't come out more physical than they mm-hmm. did, but why don't you have a Stortini in there or a Gallant in there? Like, why, or, you know, and Dan Kelly is there, but he really didn't do the big body stuff that he normally does at all.
Yeah, I don't think he played the last 25 minutes of the game.
Yeah, so I mean, that is a question of what's kind of going on, because if you look at the last few games of the regular season, I mean, Gallant was all but gone. Yeah, I mean, he came out for a few warm-ups and then he was scratched almost every night, but you had Stortini in there. But then playoffs roll around and you don't have either one of those fighters out there. And yeah, maybe they don't want the fights to be happening during playoffs because they don't want injuries, but you still need that big body to push around, because as much as I love the fact that Nikita Yevpolov tries to be that guy, he's not the big body guy, right? So he comes out and he definitely tries to heckle them and lay those forechecks and all that stuff, but he's just... I do have to say, though, last night, I can't remember exactly. I'm sure you guys saw that. I can't remember exactly which period it was in. Probably the second. But he takes a hit from behind and just falls completely to the ground. Everybody is racing down ice, and he's just sitting there. And then he looks up. And I swear, yes, he looked up to see, did anyone see that? No? Okay. And then he gets up like nothing happened. I was like, did he just flop? Like, what just happened? But I love that, especially towards the end of the season, he has come out like, well, if nobody else is going to do it, I guess I'll do it. But yeah, no, I mean, that's a question to me, is why why don't you have those big body guys out? But I mean, and I guess as we move forward into the playoffs, that's going to be less and less necessary.
It's because you have the 5'8" beast Colin Blackwell leveling Brandon Bolig. So who needs these physical guys when you got Colin Blackwell?
You know, but it's interesting because the chat's bringing up something too. And a player that is, I think, has been a little conspicuous in his absence is Adam Haluka.
Yes, absolutely.
When was the last time he scored, though?
I don't know, but I love Adam Haluka.
I mean, I feel like with Haluka, that's Sommer sending a message.
Possibly. I mean, from what I understand, he's not hurt. That's what I've gathered. But I mean, it's you know, you think it's hard getting information out of the Sharks. Try getting information on the Barracuda from up here. Yeah, I don't know. It could be a message, but at the same time, it's hard because they've had so many people kind of just parachute in lately to play. But I mean, there was one game where I think Noah Rode was in over Haluka. I'd still put Haluka in over Noah Rode at this point. Like, I like Noah Rode, but I don't know. I just
go with what got you to the playoffs kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to see. I mean, you want to obviously see what you have with Noah Rode. A little bit, even though I think he's going back to Europe next year. So, you know, I mean, I don't know. I would like to see Haluka back.
Yeah. I'm currently distracted by the video review and the Edmonton-Anaheim game. Oh. Speaking of Anaheim, let's talk about the San Diego Gulls series coming up, guys.
Yeah, let's do that. So San Diego Gulls coming up. They also went 5 games against the Ontario Reign, which I thought they were just going to roll the Ontario Reign, to be completely honest. That being said, obviously they are a little shorthanded right now as the AHL team serves to feed the parent club. So right now they have...
I know Kasha and Montour and Theodore are all...
There you go. Kevin's got my back.
If it's AHL roster questions, send them my way.
Send them to Kevin. Kevin always has my back on these. So they're a little shorthanded. But I was kind of surprised the Reign pushed them to 5. Were you surprised the Reign pushed them to 5 even with the subtractions?
Kevin, what do you got on this?
Well, no, I'm not surprised about. I mean, I don't remember what I said in the prediction. I think I did actually say San Diego in 4, but. The Reign defense, say what you want about the goaltending. Like last year, Peter Budaj, why is an NHL goalie on an AHL roster, or whatnot. That defense is damn good and has been good. They won the Calder Cup when they were in Manchester. So, I mean, that team has, if I could talk, their blue line has more or less stayed intact with a couple guys here. Let's just add Paul Ledoux just because.
Sure.
Like, oh no, oh darn. Like, Ontario is very solid defensively. So when San Diego loses some of that offensive firepower, having a D versus D matchup without your two best D does pose a problem for the Gulls. So, I like the Barracuda's chances against the Gulls, especially because of, I mean, did it, the home team win every game in the season series?
Yeah, so in the season series, we went 5-0 at home, and we went 4-1 or whatever. I mean, we won every game at home, they won every game at home. So okay. I think that's going to play a big role. And what I also want to point out about the Gulls Reign thing is you have to take into consideration the fact that you're playing your rival.
Yeah.
And rivalries always take it to the limit. I mean, yes, I think the Gulls are absolutely a better team than the Reign, and I was hoping that the Reign would just pull through on something because I would rather face them. But you have to take that into consideration that it's a rivalry. They've played each other a lot, so they know their tendencies. And you bring everything you have when you're playing a team that you hate, just like we did with Stockton. I mean, and you could see how much that those two teams didn't like each other, and it's the exact same with the Reign and the Gulls. They don't like each other, so they bring everything they have. So I think moving forward, especially, I mean, the home ice advantage has to be a big thing. I will be not so comfortable if we end up losing at one of those games at home. And I like the fact that, you know, they are a little bit shorthanded. That makes me feel better. But once again, it's a California rivalry and anything can happen. And my other thing is that San Diego brings so many fans into
that
arena.
Yeah.
They bring so many fans into that arena and they are just insane that I absolutely want to reach out to every single Barracuda fan and say, you guys have to get to these games because your team will be playing away in a sold out crowd and they want to come home to the same feeling. So if you are listening and haven't been to a game, this is the time to come for sure.
Absolutely. And that was actually going to be my end point of the show, but we'll just throw it out right now. Absolutely. Sharks fans,
go.
You're upset that the Sharks lost in the playoffs. San Jose still has plenty of quality hockey left over for you. Meaningful playoff games. Get out to a Barracuda game. Support your local team. Okay, the Sharks aren't there. These guys on the Barracuda will be the Sharks. See them now. See them now for $11. That's it.
Yeah.
Get out there, folks. You can do it.
Great plug.
Besides,
great
you get
plug,
to see though. Me in a turtleneck. Come on.
Kevin in a turtleneck. $1 hot dogs. If I was, you know what? If I wouldn't go broke on a plane ticket, I would go for the $1 hot dogs alone.
$500 plane ticket. $11 for
right.
Tickets.
Come on. Come on. How can you go wrong with that?
And let's just point out the fact, if we haven't reiterated this enough, the Barracuda won game 5 on a shorthanded goal in overtime. Who doesn't want to see that? That was amazing. That was honestly, I was telling Kevin before the show that that was the best game I have been to. And I have seen a lot of hockey this season. And that was absolutely the best way to win. I mean, I would have rather, of course, had it been, you know, 5-0. Because I wouldn't have felt so much worry and anxiety, but the elation I felt after a shorthanded goal, like I want people that don't really get hockey to realize what that means. That does not happen very often, except for the Barracuda. We see, especially with Stockton this season, it seems like that goes our way most of the time.
Yeah,
but
so apropos.
Overtime, this is do or die. You go 5 games in a series, you go an entire season long, and it comes down to one goal, and you get it on a shorthanded goal. It was amazing. So there's absolutely more hockey like that to come.
Absolutely. I mean, it was awesome. I you know, the excitement, it's great. Like, you know, I know sometimes I get people, you know, messing with me on Twitter because I'm staying up late watching AHL games, but I mean, I celebrated that goal just as much as I would have celebrated like the Donskoy goal last year. So, you know, it was fun to watch.
Pandemonium.
Be a part of.
Absolutely,
I mean,
pandemonium.
You know, even just like watching, you know, on my mediocre web stream, it's still, you know, still like an amazing, amazing thing to see. Obviously going forward, they're going to have to get their power play together. I think that's a must, especially against the goals. I feel like the goals, like, this is a team, I mean, the goals are shorthanded, but I don't think that just because they're shorthanded, the Barracuda can afford to take them lightly.
No way.
This is still a very good team. I said before the playoffs started that if they made it through to play the goals, like, the goals might push them harder than any other team would after that, and I still think that's a possibility. These teams played incredibly tight games all season long. So, I mean, this is going to be a heck of a series, yeah. I think. I'm super excited about this series.
And standings-wise, it's a battle of the two highest remaining teams in the entire league, and that's a second-round matchup.
That's right, yes, with the baby Penguins going out, Barracuda have home ice advantage the rest of the way, should they continue.
Yep.
You mean when they continue, Ian?
That's right.
I you know what? I have to. I try to wear both hats, and I do a good job, I think, of wearing both hats. I try to, you know, I don't want to come off as taking anything for granted.
No, I totally agree. I'm the same way. And I completely agree with you that this, I think, is going to be their biggest test. And I think this will be the hard, it's crazy because we just went 5 games mm-hmm. and that seemed like such a hard challenge for them. But I really do think that this is going to be harder. And if they can make it past San Diego, I think they have...
Sky's the limit.
Yeah, sky's absolutely the limit. As long as they don't beat themselves, they're going to be good to go. But this is definitely going to be an intense series that I am nervous about.
Vince G, is it 2-3-2 format for the remaining series?
Okay, I can give you the insight on that.
Kevin's going to... I know there's a nuance here. I know that this series is 2-3-2.
So when the travel time, when the travel distance is more than 300 miles between the cities, it is either a 2-3-2 or a 2-2-2-1 series, which it means it's almost always 2-3-2.
There you go.
Because of the teams in the AHL, unless you're in the Northeast, really are not that close to each other. So, yeah, basically 2-3-2. If the Barracuda advance, they'd play Grand Rapids or Chicago, clearly more than 300 miles away. So,
yeah.
Speaking of Grand Rapids, Chicago, that series started tonight. Grand Rapids won 4-1. They didn't waste any time. Martin Ferk scored 40 seconds into the game and controlled it from there. So they're up 1-0 in that series.
Wow.
Yeah, I like Grand Rapids in that series too. But
as do I.
I feel like the Barracuda match up really well against the Griffins. We saw them. I mean, you know, look at small sample size of games, but the Barracuda definitely handled their business against the Griffins during the regular season. So I'm not. They're a good team, and I don't think anyone should take the Griffins lightly. But I think that they're going to have a tougher time with the goals than they would with the Griffins.
Yep.
Yeah.
But, boy, Barracuda and goals. We kind of knew it was coming, guys.
Yeah.
Prediction time. Dun, dun, dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
Again, no sound effects anymore, folks. Sorry. Thanks. Thanks, YouTube.
Yep. you want me to go first?
Yeah.
I am going Barracuda in 6.
Ooh. Wow. I don't like this part of the show.
Yeah, no. Nobody does.
No one does.
All right, let's
I think see. You should just say John Root is going to make some noise.
What you can guarantee from this game is we're going to do a lot of yelling and towel waving and lots of noise making, and you'll see me every once in a while. But let's see. I think this is really going to be the hardest challenge for them, but I could see this going to 7, to be honest. But I I'm going to go Barracuda in 7.
I refuse to. I know that before the Barracuda came along, the goals were like my team, but I refuse to pick the goals. I refuse to pick them in this series.
I still think the Barracuda is a better team. Like, I'm not
absolutely.
Out here.
Yeah. And the Barracuda have all of their guns, so they just got to get back in sync, and everything should roll. And I definitely think that the Barracuda
Oilers,
have better goaltending. What?
And we need the Oilers Ducks to go to 7.
Yes.
To keep players away from the goals.
Well, unfortunately, the Ducks just tied the game back up at 2, so.
So that's good.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yay-ish. I don't know.
I have a really hard time saying yay to anything in that series right now.
Me too.
It's go Nashville and Washington.
Yeah.
I'm actually going Barracuda in 6. I don't have a rhyme or reason in this particular case. I just...
You want to hear my rhyme or reason? It's the best. Okay, so you very rarely, if I pick a series to go to 7, it's basically just me flipping a coin and saying I don't know.
Yeah, that's what I did.
All right.
Like, that's what I do. And I you know, it's I don't know, I think it's just like it's a weird thing that I've heard that TV people do, so it always kind of stuck in my head. I think Jeff Merrick said something like, if a guy picks, you know, and you never pick a sweep because you never want to burn bridges for a team you might want to work for down the road, especially if you're unemployed and doing like TV.
Well, I guess the Chicago Wolves aren't hiring me anytime soon.
Yeah, I guess so. Sorry, Kevin, you just burned your chances with the Chicago Wolves. Sorry.
Oh dear. So hey, they still won.
So you don't pick a sweep, and if you pick seven, you're just saying you don't know. And that always tend to just, it's always been in my head now. So now I just like, if I think it's going to be a long series, it's always blank and six.
There you go.
All right. Well, yeah, I've got Barracuda in six. I believe I also picked Grand Rapids in six. Toronto, I will go in five over Syracuse. And Hershey, I picked them over the Phantoms, baby. They're still alive. I'm also taking them in six over Providence.
Oh, I didn't even look at the rest of the series, man.
Yeah, right, I didn't look at them either.
All right. I don't know. Let me bring up the bracket here, and I'll tell you what I pick.
Hey, I got to be prepared at some point of the show. At least give me this.
I will give you that. oh, man, it is the Battle of the Bears. This is awesome. Wow. Who do I like? You know what? I like Hershey. I like the Marlies, and I like the Griffins. I don't.
Good job,
game-wise, I don't know. I don't.
We're both going to go 4-for-4. This is awesome.
All right. I don't watch enough to say games, so I'll just say they're all going to 7 because I just.
Wait a minute. You just. What?
Well, I don't know how many games to pick for either one because like I don't really watch a lot of the Eastern Conference. I don't watch hockey in my own time zone, man. Watching hockey in my own time zone is stupid.
Let's see. I would say. You know, God. Once again, this is the worst part of the show. I would say I have a hard time going with Hershey here, but I would probably. What was that?
You got to go against us at some point.
That's what I'm thinking.
So you get bragging rights on us. So.
I need to have my bracket up too because let's see.
We've got Vince G saying bear-on-bear violence here.
Hockey jerk with the prediction of the night. A team is going to beat another team and move on to play a third team.
Yes.
Yes. We can guarantee that, I think. Let's see.
Well, I gotta go with Hershey, though, because Hershey went to the finals last year. I just think that team is way too experienced for Providence. Yeah, Providence did knock off Wilkes-Barre Scranton, but
that goaltending ain't gonna last forever.
I don't believe in that goaltending, and Zane McIntyre really stole the show in that series. But what happens when Zane McIntyre falters?
That's why I can't do it.
Yeah.
Well, I really like all of your. Your reasoning, and you're pulling me towards you.
I'm trying.
I don't know what else to say. Okay, so let's go. All right, Chicago and Grand Rapids Griffins. And now you're in my head because I'm thinking, oh, do I say what I think or do I go against them? I'm going Grand Rapids in.
Well, how about this? We all picked Grand Rapids, so yeah. We now should get a whole bunch of followers from the Vegas Golden Knights because they will be happy that they can finally announce the Chicago Wolves as their affiliate once they get eliminated from the playoffs. So they love us for taking Grand Rapids.
There you go. Grand Rapids it is. All right. And then, you know, I kind of feel the same way. I don't really know enough about the other teams in order to really make a just decision, but I would say I'm going Syracuse. Ooh. And then I am going to take Providence. And that is only because I did not expect them to have any guns towards Wilkes-Barre. I thought Wilkes-Barre would roll right through them. And the fact that they put up such a fight, I think they could do it again.
Very good.
Very good. I like it.
Now,
I like
Vince G, I think, is smarter than all of us. He has the fact of the night. Teams that win 4 games in their series advance to the next round 100% of the time.
Wow. There you go.
The kind of knowledge. Dropping knowledge on Barracuda After Dark.
Yeah, I mean, I can't argue with these facts. These are very good facts. I guess we're just about done here. But I have an NHL topic that I need to discuss just because it's been
Let me just get to the chat real quick. Rob Amon, who is going to be the Blues' new AHL affiliate when Vegas takes over the Chicago Wolves? That has not been determined yet. My closest inside info that I have is Kansas City's back on the board, but we don't know anything more than that. I think the dominoes will fall once the Wolves get eliminated by the Griffins. So, go ahead, Ian.
All right. I have to talk about this just because it's been the topic du jour. The Sidney Crosby thing and the fallout from it. Especially, right. Did you see the Rossi stuff?
I heard about it.
Okay, because you're the wrestling guy, so I need to know, like, promo wise, how good was did you see the promo?
No, but
Barry Trotz. Oh, you let me down, Kevin. You were the wrestling guy. I needed to know, like,
well, you know something, brother. We're gonna take Sidney Crosby out and give it 110%.
Oh man. Okay. Well, this is your homework for next show.
Okay.
You need to watch the promo that Bob Rossi dropped on
Barry Trotz.
On Barry Trotz, and okay. Then you need to rate it for next show.
Great.
What is your take on this whole situation? I think that Niskanen's not the guy that everyone should be looking at. It should be Ovechkin.
Yes. I completely agree. I mean, I don't know. I was so focused on the actual collision between Niskanen and Crosby that I didn't see exactly what happened with Ovechkin. I heard it was some kind of slash that spiraled Crosby out of control.
Yeah.
I don't know what Niskanen's supposed to do in that situation. Yeah, he has just enough time to brace himself, which is why his arms got up.
Right.
And I don't remember who it was, but someone said someone called Jay Beagle out for saying it was a clean hit. It wasn't a clean hit, but I mean, there are things called incidental contact. And right. I don't know what Niskanen's supposed to do. Okay, he got thrown out of the game, whatever. But to calling for a suspension, like, I don't know, I've seen way worse in the playoffs. Jarrett Stahl that has been let go. So, no, I that sucks for Crosby. You know, I have been very vocal about how I'm not his biggest fan as a player. But right. Nevertheless, that's terrible for him, terrible for hockey. I feel bad for him, but I don't know what Matt Niskanen is supposed to do there.
Me neither. And I think, like, for my take on it, when I look at it, when you cross-check somebody, and being a guy who's thrown a few cross-checks in his day, I generally get my hands a little wider out on my stick, right? Like, they're not like this. They're like this because I'm not going to, you know, I'm not punching the guy in the back. I want to get him with my stick. And I felt like with the way that Niskanen kind of got him, like if he was trying to cross-check him, even if it was intended to be like not in the head, like you're gonna get your arms out a little bit more on your stick. Like that's just my take.
Yeah. Kaleigh, do you have any thoughts on that topic?
I mean, I kind of agree. From what I've read, it really does. You know, and I haven't seen this play. So okay. I can't say I heard about it. I read some things on it, but I haven't actually seen it. So, but okay. What I do hear in the, in basically the forum of the internet is that it really is.
Oh no, not HF boards. Please no.
No. I don't mean an actual forum. I just mean over the internets. What I see is that really it was Ovechkin that caused him to kind of spiral out of control, and the only option was to do what happened. So I think it's something that needs to be looked into. However, I'm not the type of fan that likes to just hand out suspensions all the way around. I think we do that too much in football. We do that way too much in baseball. And I like to keep hockey the way it is. And if you're not going to regulate things as heavily as in those other sports, then it happened. It happened. Sorry, but get over it.
Yeah.
And I think too, like, The one thing I think that really bothers me about this is it's like, oh, we got to protect the stars. Like, Alex Ovechkin, fourth line player, clearly. You know, we got to protect the stars from the goons and the non-talented people in this league. It's Alex Ovechkin. Like, I think that's the narrative that drives me the most crazy is, like, yeah, I get you don't want, like, I understand that you want to keep star players away from, like, the Matt Cooks of the world, which, you know, the Penguins also employed at one point. I get that. But, like, it, you know, we need to protect the stars from, you know, Sidney Crosby's the best, you know, like, Alex Ovechkin's pretty good, too. Like, last I checked, Alex Ovechkin, pretty good at hockey.
That's what's kind of upsetting, too, is especially for anybody to come out and say, protect the stars. Well, why not protect all of the players? Like, if you're going to do it for one person, you have to be willing to do it for everyone. And Sidney Crosby is playing just as hard as, I'm going to say, anybody on the lower lines or in the AHL, they're playing just as hard to try to get to where he is. So why, if you're not going to protect the nobodies that are playing for, you know, an ECHL team,
why is it a special circumstance?
Why is it a special circumstance, exactly? Because how are these younger players supposed to get to be the Sidney Crosbys of the world if you're not protecting them? But
yeah, right.
But I agree that I really don't think that anything should happen, to be honest, but that's, you know, that's just me.
No, I agree. I think the penalty, even the penalty that Niskanen got, was a little much, but at the same time, like, you know, I think it was a slew foot that Ovi got. And look, I hate the slew foot. Yes, I will lick the Goldobin bobblehead tonight. I hate slew foots. Like, slew foot is probably the worst thing you could ever do to another player in hockey. But at the same time, like, Ovechkin has to do something. Crosby's, you know, in a high danger area, and he's Sidney Crosby. Like, you can't just not, you know, we just can't not hit Crosby in that situation. Like, obviously, you don't want the end result to be as bad as, you know, as bad as it ended up being, but at the same time, like, something has to happen to Crosby in that situation. You can't just give him a free pass through the crease because he's Sidney Crosby. If that makes any sense. I think I make sense.
I agree.
Put a stop sign on the back of the jerseys. Hockey Jerk says he's right. I gotta look for Goldobin. Okay, he's right there. Kevin, any other things you wanna discuss quickly?
Yeah, I'm trying to pull it up here.
Grab the Goldobin bobblehead.
Kaleigh, Ian has this weird fetish about licking the Nikolai Goldobin bobblehead.
I did it once, and now it's a thing. I have to do it. The fans want it. I can't. I'm a man of the
You people. Can't deny the
deny fans. The fans. Wow. All right. Well,
I'm trying to. AO12345 said something about, like, Logan Couture paid off Matt Niskanen to take out Sidney Crosby over the face-off from last year or something like that. That was pretty cool. I guess in close, I just want to say, you know, fantastic job, Barracuda. And for those of you listening on our audio stream on iTunes, Google Play, SoundCloud, Stitcher, or TuneIn, that was the appearance of the Nikolai Goldobin bobblehead. Like how I threw all those in? Yeah. So, Barracuda, job well done. Thank you, Timo Meyer. Thank you, Ryan Carpenter. In fact, thank you, Timo Meyer, for reading my tweet about score one goal and go win in overtime. It's not impossible. And then 8 minutes later, he went and did it. So thank you for that. But overall, just I am really excited for the Barracuda going forward. This is going to be the biggest test for them. A job well done in round one. Way to go. And Nicole Sorcy put out, I don't know if you are familiar with her, but she's a kind of a blogger about the AHL and ECHL. She wrote an article yesterday, I think, about go see your local minor league teams because it's a lot of fun. And I will retweet it at KevinLacey22 for those of you. I tweeted it yesterday. But read her article and then go see the Barracuda this round. You will not be disappointed. Spend $11 and go.
Yeah, go. Be awesome. All right, I will lick the Goldobin bobblehead.
Oh, this is weird. Poor Goldie. I wish he knew what was happening.
Back on the show now.
I know. Sorry, I've chased everyone away. For you people that live in the Bay Area, I envy you because I would so totally go to an $11 Barracuda game and eat all my $1 hot dogs. These guys are great. You know, some of these kids I followed since junior. So I mean, it's, you know, to get them to continue their journey on their way to the NHL, as we all hope, it's special. And you know, now that I had to do that, you're right, this is why Goldobin got traded. I licked the bobblehead, and then he was traded after. This show fires coaches and trades players.
That's right. We got 4 coaches fired this season, Kaleigh.
Wow.
I got Patrick Waugh to quit, and then we got, who do we get?
Hey, what does that mean for me?
You're good. Don't worry. We didn't speculate on you losing your job. Therefore, you will not lose your job.
You're not losing your job. You're A-okay
with us, too. All right. Thank goodness.
You're okay. No. But we did speculate about 3 coaches during the season, and within 2 days, all 3 of them got fired.
Gerard Gallant.
Ken Hitchcock. That was the...
Ken Hitchcock.
And then Jack Capuano.
Yeah, Jack Capuano. You're right.
By the way, Anaheim scored again.
Yay, long series.
Oh, I just remembered one other thing. Negative 28 days till Vladimir Sobotka signs with the St. Louis Blues.
Oh, man.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Perfect. All right, let's get us out of here. Thank you, Kaleigh, for coming on the show. You're welcome here anytime.
Thank you very much. I had a great time.
Awesome. Kevin, any final thoughts before we let Kaleigh tell everyone where they can find her?
You can find me bugging Kaleigh at Kevin Lacey 22. Other than that, I got none. Thank you for having me on, Ian.
Yeah, of course.
Awesome. All right, guys. Well, you can follow me on Twitter at Miss Krish, and I am on Instagram at Cakes, K-A-K-E-S 88. Yes, they don't match up because, you know, I'm a lot older than most of you people. So, but no, anyway, these series are going to be amazing. And I'm so proud of this team for getting past the first round and into the second round for the first time in their franchise history.
Yes.
I'm so excited to be a part of that. And let's go get that Calder Cup.
Absolutely.
By the way, the Google chat all saying, bring you back on. You're one of us. Great job, Kaleigh.
Aw, thanks, guys. Go. Next time, I'll let you actually see me.
Yay.
If you don't have video, I'm just going to rip the Jumbotron video and just have it playing every time you talk.
You're
interviewing Ryan Carpenter, but no one actually... Anyway. Yeah.
Which, by the way, if anybody has footage of that interview or can get it, please do, because that was such a great interview and it's so much fun. I would love to share it with people. So I'm going to try, but if anybody else has pictures or video, please tweet them at me.
I will do my best. I'll have to go back when the replay hits and see if I can get it. The problem is Julia have like Nolenbergers over top of any arena.
Exactly. I never have any audio. Thanks, Nolenberger.
Oh, what a jerk.
Jeez, Nolenberger.
Oh, that's a good question, Vince G. Yeah, you know what? One of these days, we will do an NHL show again at some point. It's going to be difficult. Barracuda schedule, as far as I know, so some programming notes going forward. The Barracuda games on the weekends, we're good. We'll be here after the game. The ones, anything that falls on a weekday is just really dicey, so I can't promise to be here. I can't say that none of the other guys will pick up the torch and run with it without me, but I can't be on those. I can't do all these games are night games, and with 8:30 classes in the morning, I can't do it, guys. This semester has been far too intense, and it's only a week old. So we will definitely be on after any Barracuda weekend games, and then we'll play by ear for what we'll do for during the week. Aside from that, you can find me at Ian Blogs Hockey on the Twitter machine. You can find my writing, which hasn't been very much lately, and I apologize for that, on Teal Town USA. AO says Zach will be talking to himself. Man, that's good. We'll try and do something. If we can't get other guys to come on and do a show, we will try and do like something like we did today, where we came on after, you know, the day after and came on it, you know, at 7 or whatever.
And thank you to all of you who are watching or listening to us, because obviously there has been time for the adrenaline to lessen, But we hope that you guys are excited as we were about the Barracuda, because, man, it's still a rush here 24 hours later.
No. Yeah, I mean, it killed me not to do that show last night because God knows I wanted to, but I just, it's too much. I gotta, you know what, this is my favorite thing in the world, but it's a hobby, and I have to treat it as a hobby and not a job. It is what it is. Other than that, guys, thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Be sure to check us out. Like I said, Teal Town USA, subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. On this YouTube channel, you'll find us. You'll find the After Dark crew when the Sharks start playing again. It's going to be great. Aside from that, guys, thanks very much for watching and have a good night.